Are we ready to start?
We are.
Sound is ready.
Let me get rid of this.
Yeah, take your time.
And I guess I'm the only one on camera? Or are they gonna shoot you, son?
Oh, no, just you.
Okay, just me, okay.
What's your favorite virtue?
Integrity.
What do you appreciate most in your friends?
Honesty.
Your idea of happiness?
A day on the South Fork of the Snake with a fly rod.
Your idea of misery?
Loss of a family member.
What's your favorite food?
Spaghetti.
What do you consider your main fault?
My main fault? Well, I don't spend a lot of time thinking about my faults, I guess would be the answer.
When was the first time you went fishing after your heart transplant?
This is it. I haven't been on the river since last summer. It's an important part of my life, fly fishing. It requires intense concentration to do it well. It's one of the few things I was able to do over the years that let me put everything else out of my mind. It didn't matter what else was happening. If I was out on the stream, I was out on the stream. That's what I was focused on.
There is panic on the street. Thousands of people running up Church Street.
There was smoke everywhere. People jumping out the window.
The second building that was hit by the plane has just...
People say, well, you know, how did you feel? That's not the way I think about it. I had a job to do.
Secret Service agent came in. He said, sir, we have to leave immediately. He propelled me out of my office and down the hall. I got on the telephone with the president, who was in Florida, and told him not to be in one location where we could both be taken out.
We had a list of 6 aircraft that had been hijacked. We could account for 3 of them. 2 in New York and 1 in the Pentagon. But we had 3 more out there, and we didn't know where they were. There had been a report of a plane outside Washington, 80 or 90 miles away, headed for Washington at a high rate of speed. You know, you could wring your hands and be worried and get emotional about it, then you can't function. Under those circumstances, you've got to act. You know, you've got to deal with the situation as it arises. You've got to anticipate difficulties. That's the nature of conflict. A plane 80 miles out, traveling at a high rate of speed to Washington is a matter of minutes before it arrives over the city. I gave the instructions that we'd authorize our pilots to take it out.
Dick Cheney unquestionably is the most powerful vice president in history. He changed the course of history in a way that no vice president has.
He didn't see his role as galvanizing public opinion. He wasn't a vice president that went out with a new initiative and tried to build public support.
He did not want to be flexible. He just felt you had to get in the face of the terrorists or the potential threats and use extreme measures.
It wasn't just about protecting American power, it was about projecting American power.
Almost any man can stand up under adversity,
But if you want to really know a man's character, give him power.
The ones who spend all their time trying to be loved by everybody probably aren't doing much. If you're not prepared to have critics and to be subject to criticism, then, wrong line of work. If you want to be loved, go be a movie star.
Richard Bruce Cheney grew up in Casper, Wyoming. The dramatic landscape of his home made a lasting impression on him.
There's something just very special about it, the sense of space, sense of freedom and sense of possibilities. We loved to fish. Dad got us actively involved in fishing. Dad was very much aware his whole life of the possibility that, economic disaster could be around the next corner. They were diligent, hardworking. And both sides of the family were lifelong Democrats. Somebody had asked me, was I a Democrat or Republican? I probably would have said, my family's all Democrats. High school was a good time. Played football, played baseball, was senior class president. Everybody knew who Lynn was. She was a star. She was state champion, baton twirler, and she was very attractive. You couldn't miss her.
He wasn't flashy, but as I got to know him better, I found him one of the most thoughtful people I'd ever known.
It was before the advent of the 60s. Nobody ever saw drugs in Casper in the 1950s. The most potent thing that was out there was a can of beer. We didn't face the kinds of problems and challenges that later generations did.
Upon Cheney's graduation from high school, a local oil man arranges a scholarship for him to attend Yale University.
Totally different environment from what I was used to. Trees and buildings and people everywhere. I was all hemmed in. I didn't work at my academics. I found a bunch of friends who consumed a lot of beer, just as I did.
Cheney feels powerless in an environment that favors the elite.
He can't measure up. These kids are too smart. They're maybe too privileged. They are too well-nourished educationally.
Cheney fails out of Yale in his freshman year. He is allowed to return, but his scholarship is taken away. In his sophomore year, Cheney is asked to leave for good.
You gotta realize, we didn't have to work that hard in high school in Casper, and I think we had good grades, but it may not have been a consequence totally of all our hard work.
I was stunned. I was very surprised. His parents had a letter from the dean that said that he'd become involved with a spirited group of young men.
Were they disappointed in you at that time?
I'm sure they were, and I gave them a reason to disapprove back when I was 19, 20, 21 years old.
Cheney gives up on his college education and returns to Wyoming. He finds work as a manual laborer, laying electrical cable.
I lived pretty much day to day, paycheck to paycheck. There were times when it was be a gap between jobs, but then you could probably get credit at the local bar and they'd run a tab for you until you got a paycheck. When you came in at night or after work, you'd go to the bar and down large quantities of Coors beer.
Cheney is arrested twice in the span of 9 months for drunk driving.
When I was arrested for the second time for driving under the influence in Rock Springs, that was very sobering. My friends and classmates at Yale were all graduating. Leonard graduated the previous year early from Colorado College, and I was in jail in Rock Springs, Wyoming. The real question is, what are you gonna do now?
At the age of 22, Cheney is an itinerant lineman who has flunked out of Yale twice with a growing arrest record and a drinking problem. He has hit bottom.
He fails again and again in the early part of his life, all the way up until Lynn basically takes him and shakes him. She says, I am not going to be married to a lineman, so step up, buddy.
What did Lynn say to you? What was that conversation?
That's still private. It's there. There's, it was clear she disapproved. I needed to get my act together. I needed to go back to school and get an education.
From now on, Cheney will control his own fate. He begins classes at the University of Wyoming, majoring in political science.
Turned out when I went back and applied myself, I was a pretty good student. A year later, Lynn finally agreed to get married.
After getting his bachelor's degree, Cheney enters the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Once he has his doctorate, the former college dropout plans to be a professor of political science.
The time to act is now, clearly and decisively against the war in Vietnam.
Student protests against the Vietnam War are growing in numbers. On the East Coast, the center of the movement is Columbia University. On the West Coast, it's Berkeley. And in the Midwest, it's the University of Wisconsin.
Wisconsin had a reputation of being a pretty radical campus. Riots and protests of various kinds. National Guard was called out to restore order. I can remember the mime troop meeting there and the guys that ran around in white sheets with the entrails of pigs dripping blood. I basically supported what the administration was doing at that point. So I was not an opponent of the war.
I mean, the country's deeply divided in a way you really almost hadn't seen since the Civil War.
We were trying very hard to get on with our lives, to complete our educations, and start a family, and so forth.
A period of time when I think probably a lot of us made judgments or ended up having our political philosophy shaped and developed by what we saw happening in the society. And it certainly moved us in a conservative direction.
In 1968, a 27-year-old Cheney moves to Washington to participate in a fellowship that pairs graduate students with members of Congress. He wants to spend a year experiencing the political process up close before returning to his studies.
There was an orientation session for those of us in the Congressional Fellowship Program. One of the early speakers was a guy named Don Rumsfeld I'd never heard of. He was young, dynamic. He was very impressive.
So, I mean, there are different ways that someone could do it. The task is there. The problem's there. The problem is to reduce the rate of increase in the cost of living, and that's what's happening.
I had agreed to interview individuals that they'd selected, and one of those individuals turned out to be a young fellow from the University of Wisconsin Graduate School.
That's probably the worst interview I ever had in my life. It's the only time I can recall that I got thrown out of the office. If you're looking for warm and fuzzy, Rumsfeld's not the right place to go. A couple months later, President Nixon announced that Rumsfeld was being nominated to be director of the Anti-Poverty Program, the old Office of Economic Opportunity.
Sit down, please. Don Rumsfeld today is making what for him may be his hardest and most important political decision. He's giving up one of the safest seats in the Congress of the United States to take on one of the most important agencies, one of the most controversial agencies in the entire government.
I sat down one night, unsolicited, and wrote a 12-page memo telling Rumsfeld what he should do in terms of confirmation hearings, how he should conduct himself.
I ended up liking the memo and remembering Dick Cheney and asking him if he'd come to work with me.
He looked up when I came in and he said, you're congressional relations, now get the hell out of here. And I went down the hall and moved in and took over. We had offices over in the West Wing. That's prime real estate, especially for a young guy in Washington.
The tougher things got, the better he got. He didn't ever get skittish or back off. He would decide what needed to be done and then go about and do it.
In one of the elevators of the
Rumsfeld is a very combative bureaucratic player. Wherever he is, he's pushing for more turf for himself. So Cheney watches all that, learning at Rumsfeld's feet.
And this is the beginning of Cheney's sort of growth. His first role as the guy right behind you, the number two, the guy who is gonna stay up twice as late as you, the guy's thinking of things before you even think of them.
How much exposure did you have to President Nixon during those years when you were?
He was probably the first president I ever met, shook hands with. Rumsfeld took some of us into the Oval Office one day, and sort of a morale booster, and different cabinet members would bring their key staff in.
As the 1972 election draws near, Cheney is offered a job working for Nixon's committee to re-elect the president. But Rumsfeld wants to keep his trusted deputy.
I made a good decision. I went with Rumsfeld, so I was not near when the train wreck happened.
A federal grand jury indicts seven former aides and campaign associates of President Nixon's.
With Nixon's approval, a group of government-paid operatives spies on the president's political enemies. Nixon's men are caught during a burglary at the Watergate complex. The president himself then participates in the attempt to cover up their crimes.
Watergate, obviously, was absolutely devastating. Having known some of the people involved and watching that whole thing unfold, it was a political scandal of major proportions.
More than 50,000 telegrams poured in on Capitol Hill today. So many, Western Union was swamped.
They just say, impeach Richard Nixon or force him to resign.
As the Watergate scandal shakes the country, Nixon's vice president, Spiro Agnew, is charged with bribery and forced from office.
The vice president of the United States, Congressman Gerald Ford of Michigan.
Nixon chooses House Minority Leader Gerald Ford as his new vice president, the first unelected vice president in United States history.
Through 73 and on into the summer of 74, those were the sort of the crucial 18 months of Watergate.
He did have a front row seat. He could see everything evolve sort of at every step along the way.
And in all of my years of public life, I have never obstructed justice.
How can you talk about blackmail and bribery and keeping witnesses silent? This is the presidency of the United States.
Congress became very aggressive at trying to reassert some balance of power in the federal government.
The Congress sort of felt their oats when you've got the president in your sights and you've got the prospects of impeachment. That, you know, radically shifts the balance between the two branches.
The meeting will come to order for the House of Representatives to exercise its constitutional power to impeach Richard M. Nixon.
I have never been a quitter. To leave office before my term is completed is abhorrent to every instinct in my body.
Vice President Ford will become the nation's 38th president tomorrow.
Indications are Ford will ask the entire Nixon cabinet to stay on. Ford's choice for vice president, Nelson Rockefeller.
On August 9th, 1974, Gerald R. Ford is sworn in as the 38th president of the United States.
He became the only man in our history to become president, having never run for vice president or president. So he didn't have a campaign team. He didn't have a policy team. He didn't have a platform.
My fellow Americans, our long national nightmare is over.
Within days of taking office, President Ford's approval ratings reached 71%. But 1 month later, Ford squanders the goodwill.
Today, in a move which caught just about everybody by surprise, President Ford made the most controversial decision he has made since assuming office just 1 month ago tomorrow.
Now, therefore, I, Gerald R. Ford, have granted a full, free, and absolute pardon unto Richard Nixon for all offenses against the United States, which he...
It came as a stunning action, a shock to the American people.
This means Mr. Nixon cannot be prosecuted for any possible Watergate crimes.
Do you think that the Nixon pardon really served to bind up the nation's wounds?
The decision has created more antagonism than I anticipated.
Do you think that there is any evidence that there was a deal made between Mr. Nixon and Mr. Ford?
I think we have to say that there are a lot of unanswered questions tonight.
Just how much damage has this done to the president's relations with Congress?
I would predict a rough going for Mr. Ford from now on in his dealings with Congress.
Ford needs help. He brings in Donald Rumsfeld as his new chief of staff. Rumsfeld then hires a 33-year-old Dick Cheney as the second in command.
I'd gone from being the assistant to Rumsfeld, and all of a sudden I'm the number two and the deputy chief of staff in the White House. I'm 33 years old. Based on Rumsfeld's word, Gerry Ford immediately gave me his approval. Working for Ford, I got a much closer post from which to observe the presidency and all the pressures that are exerted on a president, the decisions that needed to be made.
One day Ford would have a note sent to Cheney that said, can you schedule my haircut? And the next day would say, what's the status on our nukes?
The first task Cheney and Rumsfeld face is restoring the authority of the president. Congress is demanding that Ford appear on Capitol Hill to explain his pardon of Nixon. Rumsfeld and other staffers plead with Ford not to go to Congress.
What was the risk of his going to Congress?
Precedent it sets. One of the things you have to be aware of and sensitive to, I think, as president, is that the things you do are important not only for the here and now, but they oftentimes can have an impact long term.
You would not expect a leader of the executive branch to go, in effect, hat in hand to the legislative branch and answer their questions. But Ford thought that was important, and he overruled Rumsfeld and he overruled Cheney.
Just 1 month after joining the Ford White House, Cheney watches from the gallery as the president is humbled by Congress.
I'm wondering if, after all that has happened and with further opportunity for reflection, if you do not now feel that you perhaps acted too hastily in this case.
I was absolutely convinced then, as I am now, that if we had had an indictment, a trial, a conviction, that the attention of the president, the Congress, and the American people would have been diverted from the problems that we have to solve.
Ford's testimony is one of the very first instances where Cheney sees the impact of and objects to congressional intrusions on presidential power.
I think there's no question, but those days after Watergate, the presidency was in a weakened condition. Congress sort of moved aggressively into the vacuum that had been filled by that.
Rumsfeld and Cheney develop a kind of autonomy and also a kind of a leverage over others.
Behind their backs, members of the administration begin calling Cheney and Rumsfeld the Praetorian Guard, referring to elite soldiers in ancient Rome who protected the emperor, but also wielded tremendous power themselves.
There was a lot of tension between the Ford staff and the Nixon White House staff, which President Ford had decided to keep.
Rumsfeld and Cheney often knocked heads with Henry Kissinger.
Henry had two hats. He was the Secretary of State and he was the National Security Advisor.
Kissinger was larger than life and Ford deferred to him.
But Cheney and Rumsfeld distrust Kissinger because they consider him soft on the Soviet Union.
Rumsfeld and Cheney were also maneuvering against several other people.
I did not have a close relationship with Vice President Nelson Rockefeller. He and I were hostile. I was the young kid. Half his age.
There was a feeling that Rockefeller was probably too liberal for Republicans.
You know, he had lots of ideas for new social programs like the ones that he had done in New York as governor.
Rockefeller believed I was the guy shooting down his proposals, which to some extent I was.
The internal conflicts come to a head just as the presidential primary campaign begins.
All governments are going to have to reduce government's appetite and let the people have a little more of their own money in their pockets to spend as they see fit, or this system of ours isn't going to work any longer.
Ford, still reeling from his pardon of Nixon, is vulnerable to a primary challenge from Ronald Reagan, the popular and deeply conservative former governor of California.
And you don't discipline an irresponsible and wasteful Congress by putting an indulgent friend in the White House.
Rumsfeld and Cheney are determined to shore up the Republican base by pushing the moderate president further to the right.
We thought the president needed to make some changes that he had been slow in arriving at.
Rumsfeld and I, we wrote a lengthy memo to the president that recommended a lot of changes.
Over the course of 3 days, Cheney and Rumsfeld engineer what comes to be known as the Halloween Massacre.
They knock out the core staff of the Ford administration.
Henry Kissinger is forced to give up his duties as National Security Advisor.
You've got a guy who's dominant in the Nixon administration and who had survived all of that, but he's running your foreign policy, so you needed to mix things up a bit there. So he went down.
They as well kneecapped Nelson Rockefeller, you know, the vice president.
Rockefeller announces he will not run for election in 1976. Secretary of Defense James Schlesinger is removed from office.
Were you fired or did you quit?
Well, I have no comment to make.
Cheney and Rumsfeld have two more moves to make. Ford names Rumsfeld as the new Secretary of Defense. And at the age of 34, Dick Cheney becomes the youngest White House Chief of Staff in American history.
Pretty sophisticated series of chess moves.
Mm-hmm. Right. That first, you know, major turning moment in my life was the summer of 63. 12 years later, I'm Chief of Staff, the youngest one in history. So that was a major transformation, obviously, from where I had been 12 years before.
He said to me that he didn't spend a lot of time thinking about it, that he had a job to do and things were in front of him. But one would imagine that if you're Chief of Staff at the White House and you're in your mid-30s, that's a moment where you do take some time to stop and sort of reflect and say, you know, this is a big moment for me.
But Cheney's rise to power is just beginning. After serving in the Ford White House, Cheney goes on to represent Wyoming in Congress for 10 years.
Mr. Speaker, this bill is a turkey and I would urge its defeat.
It didn't take a lot of insight to figure that Dick Cheney was going to make his mark.
In the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it, and Mr. Cheney is elected minority whip.
He quickly ascends to the Republican congressional leadership. As a member of the Intelligence Committee, he masters the complexities of national security and international relations. And when Ronald Reagan comes under fire for the covert operations known as Iran-Contra, Representative Cheney's expertise in the intelligence world helps him gain the position of ranking member of the House Committee investigating the president's actions.
In my opinion, there's no justification for further restrictions on the power and flexibility of future presidents.
The Iran-Contra hearings make Dick Cheney a household name. In 1989, after George H.W. Bush is elected president, he asks Cheney to serve as his Secretary of Defense.
There are 92 yeas and no nays. The nomination of Richard B. Cheney to be Secretary of Defense is confirmed.
2 years later, Cheney leads efforts to build a multinational coalition to fight Iraq in the Persian Gulf War.
We did exactly what we set out to do. We liberated Kuwait, and we destroyed the vast bulk of Saddam Hussein's offensive military capability.
Mr. Secretary, you managed an immense enterprise with startling success, a military and civilian defense system without equal in history.
On this day, the American people have voted to make a new beginning.
When George H.W. Bush loses his bid for re-election, Cheney finds himself out of a job, but he has his eye on a new one, President of the United States. He drives thousands of miles crisscrossing the country trying to drum up support.
Spent a lot of time on the road. I thought that I was qualified by background and experience to do the job. I mean, I believed that I could function effectively as president.
He did all the things that you're supposed to do. You raise a little money, you form a political action committee, you put out feelers.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dick Cheney.
Part of that was to assess that basic question about my willingness to do what I would have to do. And there's no guarantee you can't just say I'm gonna run and expect to get elected.
Are you testing the Iowa waters?
Well, I'm out to all across the country this year because it's a campaign year, helping the party, helping candidates, and tonight I have the—
He is not good at retail politics. And more importantly, he doesn't like it.
Cheney never garners more than 3% support in pre-election polls. His fundraising lags far behind other contenders like Pat Buchanan, Lamar Alexander, and the eventual nominee, Bob Dole.
I put out in about a one-word, two-word press release, thanking my supporters for their interest and saying I'd made a decision not to be a candidate. Thank you very much.
Cheney realizes he will never be elected president. He retires to private life, accepting a job as CEO of Halliburton, a multinational oil company.
I did that for 5 years, and I was very happy doing it. We had over 100,000 employees and over 100 countries around the world, and we were involved in a wide range of basically energy-based activities. Dad was a religious consumer of information about the company. Said to my brother one day, showed him the annual report and said, look at that, can you imagine what they're paying the kid? And that was his take on my time at Halliburton.
Cheney really never extinguished his political ambitions. He always said he did. You know, maybe in his own mind he did. But, you know, once you're a political animal, you know where the big seat in the zoo is, and it's being president of the United States.
We are proud to introduce you today to the future president of this great nation, Governor George W. Bush.
In the summer of 2000, Texas Governor George W. Bush becomes the presumptive Republican nominee for president.
I'm looking forward to working my heart out for the next 4 months. 4 months till we rid this nation of Clinton Gore. 4 months.
Bush faces a tough election against incumbent Vice President Al Gore. Questions are being raised about the governor's foreign policy experience.
Prime Minister of India?
The new Prime Minister of India is, no.
Bush needs to reassure voters worried about his limited resume. His choice of a running mate is a chance to put those concerns to rest.
Former Secretary Dick Cheney is going to head my vice presidential search committee.
Bush asks Cheney to be considered as a vice presidential candidate. Cheney says no.
I had seen the unpleasantness a number of other vice presidents had negative experiences. Jerry Ford always told me, he said, the worst job he ever had in his life, the worst 8 months of his life, was when he was vice president of the United States. He hated the job.
Cheney was happy in his new life at Halliburton. He had lots on his mind, lots still to do, and was not looking for the job.
But Cheney does agree to help Bush with the vice presidential search.
Honored that he would take a time out of his busy life to do so. Can't think of a better person to do it. He's a man of enormous experience. And I'd be glad to answer a few questions.
Does this mean that he is not a candidate? So rule him out.
It's a very interesting question.
Started with a list of dozens of people, all the Republican governors and all the Republican senators and virtually anybody that you could conceive of as a prospective candidate, and then we narrowed that down.
He began devising what everybody involved described as the most comprehensive, most intrusive vetting process ever used.
We wanted 10 years of tax returns. We wanted their health records. We wanted to know if they'd ever been involved in any kind of scrape that might be an embarrassment to the president.
Since he didn't trust anyone to give all the records, he made them sign waivers and powers of attorney.
It was a pretty exhaustive proposition. I'm not sure I would have gone through all of that if I'd been asked.
He would meet from time to time with Bush, tell him, here's what we found on Lamar Alexander, here's what we found on Frank Keating. Pretty much every time, you're coming up with something that raises an eyebrow or makes you worry a little bit.
During these meetings, Bush describes what he wants from a running mate.
He knew what he wanted and what he was looking for, and that was somebody who could be a part of the team to help him govern.
I can't tell you for sure when he started seeing a vice president in the mirror, but one of the key things that Cheney did was to tell Bush stories about problems between presidents and vice presidents. And the key feature that he described was a conflict involving the ambition of the number two guy. He painted a portrait of ambition as sort of latent disloyalty. If you get a guy who wants the job, he's already halfway disqualified. And at the same time, Cheney is telling Bush, no, I don't want it. And the more he runs away, the more Bush is pursuing him.
We got all through. We ended up down in Texas. We evaluated everybody. We'd reviewed all the candidates. He looked up at me and said, you're the solution to my problem. The reason I finally said yes was because I was convinced he was deadly serious about it being a consequential position. I took him seriously in terms of the reasons why he said I was the guy he wanted, my background in national security and defense. You know, there was no piece of paper at all, but that he'd make certain that I played a significant role in his administration.
Cheney did not submit himself to the vetting. He did not produce business records from Halliburton. He gave a substantial financial set of documents for vetting, and he gave them to George Bush, and George Bush only.
Cheney has amassed a long history of cardiac problems. He has suffered 3 heart attacks, his first one at age 37. But he does not provide Bush with a thorough medical evaluation.
I'd been through several crises. We'd managed each one. I'd adjusted to the fact that I was mortal. I sort of pursued a policy when I had a problem, another heart attack or crisis of some kind. You go do what you gotta do to fix it, get the best help and advice you can, and then you get on with life.
George Bush, he calls his dad and says, I'm thinking about this guy. What do you think about his health? His father advises him to get a second opinion. George Bush calls up a guy named Denton Cooley. He's a well-known heart surgeon in Houston. Says, you know, I'd like you to give a second opinion. Let's see what you think of Cheney's heart health. Well, Cooley gets on the phone, talks to Cheney's own doctor. He did not actually meet Cheney. He did not see any of his paper records. And actually, since he's a surgeon, he wasn't the right guy to ask in the first place. Should have been a medical cardiologist who reviewed those files.
Please welcome the Governor and Mrs. Bush and Secretary and Mrs. Cheney.
I believe you're looking at the next Vice President of the United States.
Bush's selection of Cheney as his running mate immediately changes public perceptions of the presidential candidate.
Cheney was not a flashy, glamorous candidate, but yet he was experienced, and as a senior statesman, he would add gravitas to the ticket.
Decision 2000, election night.
All eyes on Florida at this hour, Tim.
On election night, Bush and Cheney are on the brink of victory.
Election night was sort of the ultimate contest in terms of probably being the closest election in American history.
Here we are, 99% of the vote in. Look at that all.
11. That means automatic recount.
Yeah.
That is an underdog.
Well, I'm seeing nothing on
it. It's slightly detached.
They kept recounting, but every time they recounted, we still won. Ultimately, it got into the courts.
While the legal battles and the recount drag on, Cheney takes action.
We finally went back to Washington, and we announced that I was going to be in charge of the transition.
We will all remember these times as some of the most critical and defining moments in our nation's history.
During the deadlock 2000 election, one would think that Vice President Cheney would be glued to the television because there were literally developments, you know, every single day. Instead, actually, he was at his home in Virginia, and what he was doing was he was putting together the government in the event that the recount turned out in their favor.
It's not only unusual that Cheney ran this transition, it's unprecedented. Vice presidents, they don't run things.
One of your most important responsibilities is to put together a government to pick really good people. An awful lot of presidents find that very difficult to do. And the government's so big and they got so many relationships that they sometimes they like to hang on to old relationships that are no longer relevant.
George Bush is very limited in his Washington experience. He doesn't know the kinds of people who are going to fill jobs like Office of Legal Counsel. Cheney knows those people. Most of the friends of George did not make the cut. Cheney didn't say to Bush, you can't have that. It's just that he started bringing him other people.
Cheney named Scooter Libby, his former aide at the Defense Department, as his chief of staff.
He shares Cheney's philosophy. He is able to cut to the heart of issues. He is sometimes described as Cheney's Cheney.
Cheney taps David Addington, who has worked with him since the Iran-Contra investigation, as his legal counsel.
And having worked with him before, he could be confident in my abilities and importantly with Dick Cheney and my discretion.
and Cheney persuades his mentor and dear friend Donald Rumsfeld to take the job of Secretary of Defense.
It was a surprise. No one was more surprised than Don Rumsfeld that he ended up back in government at that advanced age.
We'd kept up over the years, and
when it was time to pick a Secretary of Defense, I was convinced Rumsfeld was the right guy.
The protege became, in effect, the mentor to the mentor.
He doesn't stop there. He goes to the deputies, he goes to the assistant secretaries, he goes 3-4 levels down.
There were people in the Interior Department at sort of these more mid-level kind of jobs.
It made him very influential and powerful throughout the bureaucracy, in particular when decisions came to the level of the president.
Did George W. Bush know what he was getting? How thoroughly overmatched he was by the team that was assembled around him.
Good evening, everybody. I'll make it quick and simple to beginning. The Supreme Court of the United States has reversed the decision of the Florida Supreme Court. George, this effectively ends the election.
It has ended the election. And Peter.
6 weeks after the election, the Supreme Court puts an end to the recount in Florida. Bush and Cheney win.
There were a lot of people who didn't like the outcome. Gore had won the popular vote, but we'd won the Electoral College. And that's what the Constitution provides for.
So do you remember walking into the White House as Vice President, January 20th, 2001?
I do. When I'd first arrived there back in 1968, I was one of the youngest people in the West Wing. And this time around, I was the oldest.
When the vice president first came in, they were sort of contemplating, well, what role would he take? And they were sort of, well, you know, Vice President Gore had a specific kind of portfolio involving, you know, government innovation and some other things. Cheney was not particularly warm to that kind of idea.
He had the walk-in rights, you might call them. He could walk into any project, any meeting, and do whatever he wanted.
If you are a vice president who is able to sit in on every meeting that in all of the kind of lead up when that policy is shaped, you know, you're not only the last word, the last piece of advice, but you've also shaped all of the options that are being presented to him even before they get to his desk. He was quite disciplined, though. He picked what Mary Madeline, one of his advisors, called the iron issues, the economy, national security, the core sort of areas any president would care about.
Some would suggest Cheney had his own agenda. Cheney was getting ready to manipulate the process so he could be president of the United States. Not true.
On 9/11, it's Cheney who's in charge. Bush has the humiliating experience of being in a primary school classroom. He is physically out of it.
I was thinking about the threat that we were faced with. I was thinking about what we had to do on one hand to preserve the legitimacy of the government, to make certain there were successors in line, ready to go if the president and I were taken out. There was an incoming aircraft from the Northwest. It was after the other three had already struck. The question you had to ask yourself was, if we had been able to take out one of those airplanes headed for the World Trade Center, would we have done it? And the answer was absolutely yes. After I'd given the order, it was pretty quiet. Everybody had heard it, and it obviously was a significant moment.
There was sort of this collective groan in the room, but people who looked over to see him said, you know, he was so controlled and contained.
Later in the afternoon, Lynn and I went out and got on a helicopter on the South Lawn of the White House and flew off to a secure, undisclosed location.
The only time that the vice president has ever flown in the helicopter off the South Lawn of the White House. Presidents fly off the White House lawn. Vice presidents don't do that.
Everything I'd seen up to that point had been, you know, over television and so forth. But when you fly over the Pentagon and there's a big hole in the side of it and all the signs of the attack and it's still smoking from the damage that was done that morning, was a dramatic sort of reinforcement of what we knew was happening. I started thinking about how we should respond. How can we bring to bear the power and influence of the United States to take down whoever had launched this attack against us?
We all have to work sort of the dark side, if you will. We're going to spend time in the shadows and in the intelligence world. A lot of what needs to be done here will have to be done quietly, without any discussion, using sources and methods that are available to our intelligence agencies. So it's going to be vital for us to use any means at our disposal, basically, to achieve our objective.
I see 9/11 as a hinge of history for Dick Cheney. I went to interview him a month after 9/11, and it was a changed Dick Cheney.
You see an increasing conviction that you cannot leave decisions that could be existential ones for the United States in the hands of Congress. In the face of a threat of this sort, you couldn't have some of the niceties or the same boundaries that existed before.
It is a wartime situation, and it does require tough programs and policies if you're going to be successful. And it was more important to be successful than it was to be loved.
Less than a month after 9/11, the U.S. launches attacks against al-Qaeda and its Taliban allies in Afghanistan.
We began to capture members of al-Qaeda with important information.
As we began rounding up suspects, the question was, well, what do we do with them?
We looked at all kinds of options and ended up recommending Guantanamo Bay be used.
The military base at Guantanamo Bay is entirely on the territory of Cuba, a hostile country.
Why use it? Why is it the best place?
I would characterize Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, as the least worst place we could have selected.
We needed some place to hold terrorists. We didn't want to bring them to the United States. Once they were on U.S. soil, they obtained many of the same basic rights that American citizens do. I think it was March of 2003, we actually captured Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, the mastermind of 9/11. He had a wealth of information if he were willing to share it.
There was a significant amount of consideration about, you know, how could we interrogate prisoners in such a way as to not run afoul of these Geneva Conventions.
The Geneva Convention of 1949 authorizes inspection of camps by neutrals. Yet international...
The Geneva Conventions are a protocol which specifies how prisoners of war should be treated. And most importantly, it prohibits the cruel and inhumane treatment of prisoners, and in addition to prohibiting torture.
Cheney's attorney, David Addington, drafts an order stating that these prisoners are not subject to the Geneva Conventions.
The basic proposition here is that somebody who conducts a terrorist operation, killing thousands of innocent Americans, they don't deserve to be treated as a prisoner of war. They don't deserve the same guarantees and safeguards that would be used for an American citizen going through the normal judicial process.
His office takes the lead in getting the president to essentially sign on to an order in which he says, well, we will treat prisoners as much possible in accordance with the Geneva Conventions, which of course leaves, you know, a huge hole that you can, you know, run a truck through.
Isolation in the cell or loud music, a face slap was allowed, had to be open-handed. You could push them up against a wall. There were certain things like that. Putting the individual on an incline, their head down lower than their feet, putting a towel over their face and then pouring water slowly on the towel. It creates a sensation of drowning.
We've had successive Central Intelligence Agency directors say that the information gained from those interrogations produced a major amount of the information that we had about al-Qaeda.
When you use these kinds of tactics against an individual, he will talk. Whether he'll tell you the truth or not is another matter. Khalid Sheikh Mohammed did not reveal any information about an operational plot coming to fruition, and indeed the CIA Inspector General found that nobody interrogated under the enhanced interrogation plans coughed up information that allowed us to stop any ticking time bomb.
The idea of inflicting suffering on a human being in order to force them to speak against their will was, before 9/11, an anathema in the United States.
When you talk about drawing the line, you don't consider a prolonged period of creating the sensation of drowning. You don't consider torture.
I don't. Tell me what terrorist attacks is that you would have let go forward because you didn't want to be a mean and nasty fella. Are you gonna trade the lives of a number of people because you want to preserve your honor? Or are you gonna do your job, do what's required, first and foremost, your responsibility to safeguard the United States of America and the lives of its citizens? Now, given a choice between doing what we did or backing off and say, yeah, we know you know the next attack against the United States, but we're not gonna force you to tell us what it is because it might create a bad image for us. That's not a close call for me.
Cheney's desire to protect America at all costs leads him to formulate a new national security philosophy to deal with the threats faced by the United States.
He says, if there's even a 1% chance that terrorists have gotten their hands on weapons of mass destruction, we need to treat it as a certainty.
100% effective defense against and further mass casualty attacks by the terrorists, by Al-Qaeda.
He really is the self-appointed examiner of worst-case scenarios. What could go on that would be so bad that might even make 9/11 a footnote?
Gotta figure out where the terrorists are located. What's their base of operations? Do they have access to that technology? How do they have access to that technology? Is there a state out there, a state actor that has some capability in this area? Iraq, that is a potential source for the terrorist.
Why was Iraq important to Cheney? It's because it was in a strategic location in the Middle East. The United States had defeated it once before without much difficulty, and it was a place where the United States could show the region its continuing military power.
In his first State of the Union speech after 9/11, Bush names Iraq as a new foreign policy priority for the United States.
Iraq continues to flaunt its hostility toward America and to support terror. States like these and their terrorist allies constitute an axis of evil, arming to threaten the peace of the world by seeking weapons of mass destruction.
In the wake of Bush's speech, Cheney leads the administration's effort to make a case that war with Iraq is justified because of Saddam's weapons of mass destruction.
We know he is working once again on a nuclear program.
We know they have weapons of mass destruction. We know they have active programs. There isn't any debate about it.
Of course, by 2002, we got the National Intelligence Estimate and a whole bunch of reporting that led up to that that said he had resumed his weapons of mass destruction programs.
Immediately, the intelligence services, especially the CIA, say, this is a very dangerous model, Mr. President, Mr. Vice President. A, there may well be no weapons. B, if there are weapons, when we invade the country, it may be impossible to find the weapons. To build a case for war on weapons of mass destruction is a dangerous roll of the dice.
In 1998, Bill Clinton ordered strikes on targets inside Iraq because he felt Saddam had refused to comply with the UN Security Council resolutions and in fact come clean on his weapons of mass destruction. And the whole of intelligence was collected, analyzed, and presented before George Bush and I ever got back into the Oval Office.
They never really had a meeting about whether they should attack Iraq. There was kind of an incorporated assumption.
You know, the evidence is overwhelming.
You know, he kept getting out there on Meet the Press and another venues, but it was all innuendo.
Who did the anthrax attack last fall, Tim?
We don't know.
Could it have been Saddam?
I I don't know.
I really think there was a momentum to war. Cheney is saying, we've got to do it. The intelligence is there.
He had the personnel, he had the technology, he had the know-how, he had a lot of the raw material, and he had the desire to get back into the business big time.
He said we have a lot of allies out there, but I haven't noticed any of the Arab states supporting strong action against Iraq.
Well, I think, I guess the way I would characterize it is that they are uniformly concerned about the situation in Iraq.
Bush is insecure as president. Cheney brilliantly exploits this.
Cheney points to Iraq's refusal to submit to weapons inspections as clear proof that Saddam Hussein is hiding weapons of mass destruction. But there is another explanation.
What Saddam is worried about is that his neighbors, and he's got tough neighbors, including the Iranians, will find out that he's a paper tiger, that there's nothing here.
Cheney was cherry-picking intelligence, interpreting intelligence, taking, you know, this piece and that piece.
He has been seeking to acquire the kinds of tubes that are necessary to build a centrifuge.
Colin Powell thought Cheney had a fever for attacking Iraq. Powell concluded Cheney was always twisting intelligence and exaggerating it.
Our administration is moving forward on an agenda to build a safe and prosperous future for the American people.
In August of 2002, Cheney addresses the National Convention of the Veterans of Foreign Wars. He presents his most forceful case yet for war against Iraq.
Armed with an arsenal of these weapons of terror and seated atop 10% of the world's oil reserves, Saddam Hussein could then be expected to seek domination of the entire Middle East, take control of a great portion of the world's energy supplies, and subject the United States or any other nation to nuclear blackmail. Simply stated, there is no doubt that Saddam Hussein now has weapons of mass destruction. There is no doubt that he is amassing them to use against our friends, against our allies, and against us. There is no basis to discount any of the concerns that I'm raising this morning.
3 weeks after Cheney's speech to the VFW, Bush presses Congress to authorize a war. Cheney believes that Bush, as commander-in-chief, does not need to ask Congress for permission to attack Iraq. But Bush decides that for political reasons, he needs the backing of Congress.
America's leadership and willingness to use force confirmed by the Congress is the best way to ensure compliance and avoid conflict.
We will continue working closely with members of Congress on both sides of the aisle to build a strong bipartisan resolution.
They had to win this vote, and there was a key piece on that chessboard.
As long as he behaves himself within his own borders, we should not be addressing any attack of resources against him.
Dick Armey, the majority leader in the House, a very reliable conservative, 100% rating from all the conservative groups over the years, a good friend of Dick Cheney's over the years.
Do we sometimes get caught up in wars or conflict over purposes that are in fact not imperative to maintaining our freedom and our safety? I'm afraid sometimes we do that.
Dick Armey just didn't see it. This guy Saddam, he said he's a clown, he's unfriendly to the United States, he's terrible to his own people, but a threat, a national security threat to us? If Armey had voted no, he would have given political cover to dozens and dozens of Democrats who also wanted to vote no but were afraid to do it.
This resolution is premature. There has been no showing by the intelligence agencies or the White House of imminent danger to the United States.
Mr. President, this is plain and simple, a blank check given to the President of the United States. I won't touch it.
Armey's mind will not change, and so it comes to Bush's biggest closer, Dick Cheney, to go convince his friend Dick Armey. Dick Cheney called in Armey to a little office he had off the main floor of the Capitol building, and he tells Armey a story that Saddam Hussein has made rapid progress toward the miniaturization of a nuclear warhead. He's talking about the sort of ultimate terrorist threat of a suitcase nuke. He also tells him that Saddam and his family have had direct personal contacts with Osama bin Laden and his people, so that there are very close ties. He tells the Army, I'm telling you things that are essentially too classified or too scary to tell the general public, but in fact, the situation's actually worse than we've been portraying. Almost nothing that Cheney told Army in that conversation was true. Army had a bad feeling about it, but here you have the vice president telling him, Saddam has direct ties to al-Qaeda and is getting close to building suitcase nukes. And at that point, Dick Army feels like he cannot, in good conscience, vote against the war.
Well, let me begin by thanking you all for coming. I'll make a brief statement, and then we'll open up for questions. I have decided to support President Bush and a resolution authorizing the use of force to change the current regime in Iraq. My decision follows a careful, exhaustive review of the facts and evidence against Saddam Hussein.
What made you change?
Information. The assets that Saddam has that can be destructive to people, weapons of mass destruction, is greater than what I had supposed. The degree.
3 days later, Congress votes on whether to authorize war with Iraq.
As we move towards final passage, the choice before us is this resolution, imperfect as it is, or none at all.
Because I believe it is important for America to speak with one voice at this critical moment, I will vote to give the president the authority he needs.
I take it on good faith that Dick Cheney and George W. Bush cared about protecting America. Who wouldn't? And that they were concerned and worried genuinely about threats to America. But they rigged the deck.
I have concluded, after careful and serious consideration, that a vote for the resolution best serves the security of our nation.
When you're in power, you have the ability to completely shape the debate, particularly when it involves secret information. And it's a pretty immense power.
Mr. President, we trust to you the best we have to give. Use them well so they can come home and say to our grandchildren, sleep safely, my baby.
Virtually all the Republicans voted for this, and half of the Democrats in the House and Senate.
The ayes are 77, the nays are 23. The joint resolution is passed.
You try to do everything you can diplomatically without resort to force, but our history is replete with examples where ultimately we had to use force.
And the argument that this was a war you wanted?
Wanted. Why? Because we liked war?
The opening stage of the war is a massive aerial bombardment designed to produce what the Pentagon calls shock and awe. When the ground war begins, the Iraqi army crumbles.
With each passing day, the Iraqi regime is losing control over more of the country. Coalition forces are closing in on Baghdad. Tomorrow will mark 3 weeks since Operation Iraqi Freedom began, and the progress has been nothing short of spectacular.
Today, Saddam Hussein's regime is history.
35 years into his political career, Cheney has reached the pinnacle of his power. He has reasserted presidential authority. His philosophy is now American policy.
Thank you all.
It's not enough to say, as you oftentimes do in the national security arena, well, there's only a 1% chance that's going to happen. You can't say, well, that'd only cost us 10,000 lives. You've got to be prepared to make certain they never get through again.
And he's about to fall.
The invasion is complete. Saddam has been toppled. But despite the administration's assertion that major combat operations have ended, the war in Iraq is not over yet.
There was a level of violence that people weren't anticipating.
Looting and lawlessness quickly become rampant.
My God, USA!
U.S. troops are not ordered to intervene. Donald Rumsfeld wants to bring them home as soon as possible. Many are told they will be home in a month.
His way of thinking went something like, Iraq is always going to be Iraq. You're never going to be able to create a stable constitutional government unless you stay there physically for 20 years. Let's not get tied down there.
In the aftermath of the invasion, Iraq is under military occupation. Governing it is the responsibility of the Defense Department. 2 weeks after the administration declares victory, 50,000 members of Saddam Hussein's Ba'ath Party are fired from their jobs, with Rumsfeld's approval. Most are low-level civil servants who had nothing to do with Saddam's atrocities. Without them, Iraq has no functioning government.
We expected that once you took away that top layer of leadership, that the professional bureaucracy underneath could carry on. That didn't happen.
7 days later, the Iraqi army is disbanded. General Tommy Franks, who leads the U.S. forces in Iraq, has been planning to use the Iraqi army to help provide security. Instead, the ex-soldiers and fired bureaucrats form the nucleus of an anti-American insurgency. The attacks begin 3 days after the dismissal of the Iraqi army.
Whoa! Holy shit! Oh, fuck! Get out, get out!
As the situation in Iraq begins to deteriorate, the administration faces questions about the intelligence that it used to justify the war. In the days before the Iraq War began, President Bush had presented his final and best case against Iraq in his State of the Union address. He had made a claim about Saddam Hussein's nuclear ambitions that later became known as the 16 words.
The British government has learned that Saddam Hussein recently sought significant quantities of uranium from Africa.
The origin of the 16 words dated back to late 2001. The U.S. had received a report that Iraq had bought raw uranium, known as yellowcake, from the African country of Niger. If properly treated, yellowcake could be used in a nuclear weapon. The CIA and other intelligence agencies had quickly dismissed the claim, which had been based on forged documents.
There was a fellow in the State Department who looked at these and immediately said, there's nothing to this.
But Cheney had learned of the Yellowcake report, and he had asked the CIA for more information. The CIA had then asked Joe Wilson, the former U.S. ambassador to Niger, to investigate.
Wilson was sent over there to check to see about reports that the Iraqis were seeking uranium from Niger.
He knew officials in the government and thought that he could go and talk to people and suss it out.
Ambassador Wilson told the CIA he had found no evidence confirming the report. The only thing Wilson had uncovered was one brief conversation between an Iraqi official and a former Nigerian prime minister.
The former prime minister had in fact been approached by an Iraqi delegation in 1999 wanting to establish better communications and commercial relations with Niger. Now, the only thing Niger had to export was uranium and goats. The Iraqis had plenty of goats.
7 months after Wilson's trip, Britain's MI6 intelligence agency issued a public statement saying that Saddam had in fact tried to buy uranium from Niger. Despite Wilson's report and repeated warnings from senior CIA officials, the administration decided to make the British claim part of its case for war.
Mr. Speaker,
Vice President Cheney, members of Congress, this year we gather in this chamber deeply aware of decisive days that lie ahead.
After the invasion of Iraq, Joe Wilson goes public in the New York Times.
That information was erroneous, and they knew about it well ahead of both the publication of the British White Paper and the President's State of the Union Address.
And Dick Cheney and Scooter Libby, they go ballistic.
I think it was more of a concern in the office of the vice president, frankly, than it was elsewhere in the White House.
8 days later, Wilson's wife, Valerie Plame, is named in the Washington Post. Plame is an undercover CIA agent. Her cover is blown.
Someone at 1600 Pennsylvania may have leaked the classified identity of an agency operative.
The alleged motive for outing the agent may have been revenge against her husband.
Reports today that an aide learned about the identity of a CIA agent from his boss, Vice President Dick Cheney.
Washington is completely consumed in this, and something I hadn't seen since the Lewinsky scandal.
People frequently die from revelations like this.
I do know that the President of the United States would not expect his White House to behave in that way.
If there's a leak out of my administration, I want to know who it is. If the person has violated law, the person will be taken care of.
As the scandal grows, Deputy Attorney General James Comey appoints an independent prosecutor to investigate.
Effective immediately, the United States Attorney for the Northern District of Illinois, Patrick J. Fitzgerald, will serve as special counsel in charge of this matter.
He knew who the source of the leak was. It was Rich Armitage in the State Department, the Colin Powell's deputy, was the source of the leak.
Fitzgerald does not file charges against Armitage, determining that Armitage did not know Plame was an undercover agent. Fitzgerald then investigates whether any other White House staffers leaked Plame's name.
Special prosecutor zeroed in on my office.
Libby goes before a grand jury and testifies twice under oath. His testimony and the testimony of reporters he spoke to present conflicting accounts of how Plame's name was given to the press. Meanwhile, the military's hunt for Iraqi weapons of mass destruction has turned up no actual weapons.
They want to find the factories, they want to find the raw materials, they want to find the infrastructure.
I believe, firmly believe, that when it's all said and done, the people of the United States and the world will realize that Saddam Hussein had a weapons program.
Where are the weapons of mass destruction? Please tell me.
The White House obviously was getting quite worried, and a whole narrative was developing that they had misled the country into the war.
2 months after the invasion, the CIA forms its own weapons inspection team to take over the search from the military. David Kay, a former weapons inspector for the United Nations, leads the group. During an exhaustive 8-month search, he finds nothing.
I think everybody in the military, certainly in the intelligence community, and certainly the members of the Iraq survey group would have hoped by now there would have been a breakthrough.
You just don't make decisions like we do and put our nation's youth at risk based upon something that appears not to have existed.
We know that prior to our going in, that he had spent time and effort acquiring mobile biological weapons labs. We're quite confident he did in fact have such a program. We found a couple of semi-trailers at this point, which we believe were in fact part of that program. I would deem that conclusive evidence, if you will, that he did in fact have programs for weapons of mass destruction.
6 days after Cheney's statement, Weapons Inspector David Kay appears before the Senate Armed Services Committee.
Incredibly enough, administration leaders are still saying that we found weapons of mass destruction, but today's witness, Dr. David Kay, is saying that those two trailers were for producing hydrogen for weather balloons or possibly rocket fuel, not for biological weapons.
Now the regime of Saddam Hussein is gone forever. And at a safe remove from the danger, some are now trying to cast doubt upon the decision to liberate Iraq. The ability to criticize is one of the great strengths of our democracy. But those who do so have an obligation to answer this question. How could any responsible leader have ignored the Iraqi threat?
When the facts run against him, then he tends to come up with a new rationale to explain the new facts. The rationale changes, but the bottom line doesn't.
We didn't find stockpiles. We did find that he had the capability, and we believed he had the intent.
We know Saddam Hussein had the capability to produce weapons of mass destruction. We know Saddam Hussein had the intent to arm his regime with weapons of mass destruction.
Think of how often Vice President Cheney told us that we were in imminent danger from an attack from Saddam Hussein because of arsenals of chemical and biological weapons and the rebuilding of the nuclear weapons in Iraq.
That was the reason that we did it. And then we found out that we were duped.
Yeah, I don't know any more than anyone else knows. All I know is that the fact that the stockpiles were not found and the fact that the administration had, unwisely placed so much stock in the idea that there were existing stocks, it probably would have been wiser in retrospect if the White House had focused on the fact that the basis for doing what the president decided to do was not rooted in a single thing.
The dispute over the case for war intensifies at the same time as a top secret spy program comes under challenge from within the United States government. In the wake of 9/11, Cheney had wanted to expand electronic surveillance to hunt terrorists inside the United States. Cheney and his lawyer, David Addington, had helped design a new program that would keep tabs on billions of phone calls and emails. But existing law said that a special court had to issue a warrant for each individual the government wanted to monitor.
Big problem was it didn't allow us to get a fast enough turnaround on threats to be able to effectively intercept the communications we needed to guard against a further prospective attack.
The question then arose, should we go to Congress and ask them to adjust the law? Dick Cheney was a strong proponent of not going to Congress.
Cheney knew that the Justice Department had the power to write a secret memo saying that the administration didn't need any warrants for the new widespread spying. Justice had then issued the memo.
From time to time, there may be something so sensitive that you don't want to raise the specter, the possibility that it might be leaked. And there are some things that need secrecy.
The administration now undertook a massive program of warrantless surveillance on Americans. Addington had taken charge of the paperwork.
The president had to sign an authorization every 30 or 45 days, thereabouts, to keep it going.
The program would have automatically shut down any time that approval wasn't granted. It worked. It was a good program. I think it saved a lot of lives and did a lot to allow us to thwart prospective attacks by al-Qaeda.
At the end of 2003, two new people, important people, arrive at the Justice Department. One is Jack Goldsmith, who becomes the head of the Office of Legal Counsel. And then there's a new Deputy Attorney General, Jim Comey. Jack Goldsmith starts to look at this thing. The harder he looks at it, both the technical side and the legal side, the more his head starts to hurt.
Goldsmith and Comey are conservatives. They are Republicans. They just simply happen not to be adherents to the notion that the president need not obey federal law.
The president signed up for it. Lawyers signed up for it. Original package. They had been reviewed at the appropriate level in the Justice Department, and John Ashcroft and others had signed up to it.
This debate begins between Justice and the Vice President's office primarily at the end of December 2003. It gets more and more intense in January and February and comes to a head in March.
Attorney General John Ashcroft must sign off on the program for it to continue. But he'll only sign if Comey and Goldsmith tell him it's okay. The deadline to renew the program is drawing closer. But Cheney does not tell Bush of the growing resistance at the Justice Department. 1 week before the program is due to expire, Comey meets with Ashcroft.
Comey says, "Boss, we've worked this through every way we can. We think this, and this are illegal. We don't think you should sign off on it." Ashcroft says, okay.
Go tell them to make those changes. If they don't make those changes, I'm not signing.
Hours after his conversation with Comey, Ashcroft is stricken with acute pancreatitis. He is rushed to the hospital and hovers on the brink of death.
He suddenly decided when he was sick that he was going to delegate all this authority to Comey, and Comey was then the acting attorney general.
The next day, Goldsmith tells Addington that Justice won't recertify the surveillance program. It will now expire in 5 days. 3 days later, Cheney meets with Comey and Goldsmith.
The chief of staff was there, Vice President Cheney. I was there.
Cheney says to Comey, how can you possibly reverse the department's course on something this critical to the security of the United States? Comey looks Cheney right in the eye and he says, just because you really want it doesn't mean it's legal. No lawyer who's looked really hard at this thing has said it's okay. David Addington pipes up and says, I did. Comey says, no good lawyer.
I'd call it tension in the air, yeah.
In early March, Bush is frequently away from Washington, campaigning for re-election. The day before the deadline, during a brief stop in the Capitol, Cheney finally tells him that the warrantless surveillance program is in danger.
Bush is given the impression that Ashcroft's been signing all along, but now his deputy has got the steering wheel for 5 minutes and he won't do it. He doesn't have any idea that there's been a 3-month controversy over this or that there are big substantive objections.
That night, Comey and 24 other top lawyers at Justice prepare to resign if the administration continues spying without warrants. It will be the largest resignation in the history of the United States government.
It was Wednesday, March the 10th, 2004.
And how do you remember that date so well?
This was a very memorable period in my life, probably the most difficult time in my entire professional life, and that night was probably the most difficult night of my professional life.
The next day, without telling Bush that mass resignations are on the way, Cheney advises the president to reauthorize the program without the approval of the Department of Justice.
The president extended the warrantless surveillance program in the face of the new opinion of the Justice Department that it was illegal.
The program was reauthorized without us, without a signature from the Department of Justice attesting as to its legality. I prepared a letter of resignation, intending to resign. I couldn't stay if the administration was going to engage in conduct that the Department of Justice had said had no legal basis. I simply couldn't stay.
George Bush, he doesn't know what the stakes are. You had, for example, the chief of staff of Attorney General Ashcroft saying he's going to want to resign too as soon as he's healthy enough. You have the director of the FBI, Bob Mueller, saying if Justice tells me I can't participate in this, I'm not going to, and if you order me to, I also resign. So the president now has this unprecedented meltdown happening at the Department of Justice, and he does not know it. Nobody tells him. This is March of 2004, elections coming in November. This would have been the end of Bush's presidency. He would have been a one-term president. So the next morning, they have the morning briefing, a regular Friday briefing on the terrorist threat. Condi Rice tells the president, something's on Jim Comey's mind. He's a good man. Maybe you ought to check. Bush takes him into his private dining room, and he says, what's all this I hear about you not signing? How can you possibly sort of this last minute, late in the game, suddenly tell us it's no good? Comey is floored. He says to the president, if your staff is telling you that, you are being very poorly served. Comey was planning on just resigning, but he feels now like the president doesn't understand what's happening.
Bush tells Comey to change the surveillance program and make it legal.
So what you've just had is in 24 hours, a little less than that, the president of the United States doing a complete 180. He had the day before signed an order that said, in your face, despite your objections, I'm authorizing this thing. And the next day he caves in and says, no mas, I will do it the way you say I'm allowed to do it. I will stop doing the things you say I can't do. That is unprecedented in American history.
In the end, what ended up happening were revisions were made to the program and so forth. So we had to adjust and adapt, which we did. My personal view was different, in the sense that I basically would have let them resign, because I thought the program was perfectly legitimate, it was totally necessary, and it had been totally approved and signed up to 20 separate occasions by the Attorney General of the United States. So, you know.
In his memoir, Bush writes, "I never wanted to be blindsided like that again."
Cheney is an anti-politician, but no president can be an anti-politician. No president can govern that way.
If you're a man of principle, compromise is a bit of a dirty word. The president made the decision that he wanted to avoid major controversy. It was his call, and so that's what we did.
Bush understood that this was a mortal threat to his presidency. He understood for the first time that Cheney had walked him right to the edge of a cliff, and it changed their relationship forever.
The following month, another crisis rocks the administration.
Americans did this to an Iraqi prisoner.
The nation is shocked by photos showing horrific abuses by guards at the Abu Ghraib prison in Iraq.
Ever since 9/11, the new war on terrorism with its new rules, all eyes have been on the United States.
And headlines around the world screamed torture.
Defense Secretary Rumsfeld personally approved the use of guard dogs to intimidate prisoners.
I shared a deep disgust that those prisoners were treated the way they were treated.
Everybody knew it was wrong, and the people involved in doing it, primarily because they lacked adequate supervision, ultimately were dealt with appropriately under the Uniform Code of Military Justice.
Questions remain about whether what was happening in Abu Ghraib was actually official policy. Regardless, it shook loose the fact that memos had been written approving techniques like these in certain circumstances, and it created a national debate about whether the United States was engaged in torture, and if so, should it be?
With Abu Ghraib and some of the practices at Gitmo became, you know, hugely embarrassing to the administration.
Who was in charge of the interrogations? Did they have authority over the guards? And what were the instructions that they gave to the guards?
General Smith, you want to respond?
No, Secretary Rumsfeld, in all due respect, you've got to answer this question. This is a pretty simple, straightforward question.
Pressure is mounting for Rumsfeld's resignation, both inside and outside the administration.
There are new calls for Rumsfeld to go.
Charlie Rangel, the Democratic congressman, said if Rumsfeld does not resign, he should be impeached.
For the benefit of the United States, for our country, I believe Mr. Rumsfeld has to resign.
Rumsfeld sends a resignation letter to Bush.
The president looked at making a change at defense. I argued against it. Our policies in Iraq were going well. I thought we were doing the right thing, and the strategy that was being pursued was the president's strategy.
Cheney issues a statement defending Rumsfeld, saying people should get off his case and let him do his job. Cheney convinces Rumsfeld not to resign.
Saudi Arabia is making raids and arrests. Libya is dismantling its weapons programs. The army of a free Iraq is fighting for freedom. And more than three quarters of Al-Qaeda's key members and associates have been detained or killed.
Despite the ongoing war and falling approval ratings, Bush defeats John Kerry to win re-election in 2004.
This was an historic election, and once again, I have delivered the state of Wyoming for the Bush-Cheney ticket.
The two men share the stage for the public celebration, but behind closed doors, the rift is growing between Bush and Cheney.
George Bush's two terms were almost two different presidencies. The second term was rough on both of them, rough on their relationship. It was rough on their relationship with the cabinet. It was rough on the relationships with their staffs. It's not about them, of course, it's about the country. But the country was going through two wars and having a tough time of it.
In 2000, Bush had promised to restore honor and integrity to the White House. He is frustrated by the ongoing criminal investigation of Cheney's chief of staff, Scooter Libby.
A few hours ago, a federal grand jury sitting in the District of Columbia returned a 5-count indictment against I. Lewis Libby, also known as Scooter Libby, the vice president's chief of staff.
Libby is indicted, not for the leak itself, but for lying to investigators.
Scooter did not leak that information. The investigation should have been closed at that point, problem solved, because that was the issue that they set out to investigate.
He was a very skillful Washington insider that served the vice president pretty well. I think that's one of the reasons people target him.
Fitzgerald, once he got appointed as a special prosecutor, was bound and determined to try to find somebody in the White House that he could nail. All he could come up with through that whole effort were charges against Scooter that he had misled and obstructed justice.
Once the indictment is announced, Libby resigns, costing Cheney his most senior aide. News reports about the scandal in Cheney's office are a constant distraction for President Bush. But the news from Iraq is much worse. By January 2006, the war has dragged on for almost 3 years.
We may well have some kind of presence there over a period of time, but I think the level of activity that we see today from a military standpoint, I think will clearly decline. I think they're in the last throes, if you will, of the insurgency. We've had reporting.
Sectarian strife is rampant. Shiite militias murder Sunnis with impunity. Al-Qaeda in Iraq kills Shiites daily. 500 Iraqi civilians die that January. Insurgent attacks are up to 75 a day. 62 American soldiers are killed, bringing the total to 2,243. American troops are now in the middle of a full-blown Iraqi civil war.
We're not winning. So it's grave and deteriorating, and we're not winning. We are losing. This is the time now to start to put in place the kinds of strategies that will turn this situation around.
Rumsfeld and Cheney say this war is not going as badly as people say.
I didn't think it was time for us to be signaling a change in policy.
Stock market's open, their free press is there, they've got television, they've got radio, schools are open.
Cheney and Rumsfeld are almost like one person. Brothers for decades, men who rise together, men who finish each other's sentences.
You know, they've had this long professional relationship, but it was also a deeply personal relationship.
There was a sense that they had sort of an alliance based on 30 years of working for one another and friendship.
There's very little evidence that Cheney went to Rumsfeld and said, "Don, we've got to change course."
So many American soldiers were killed, so many Iraqis were killed. Cheney should have been all over Rumsfeld on this. Went on, not just for months, but for years.
Bush is losing faith in Rumsfeld as a leader for the war. He's no longer an effective spokesman for the Pentagon. Politically, they're facing congressional elections.
It now looks like the Democrats will, in fact, win control of the House of Representatives.
Disapproval of George Bush and disapproval of the Iraq War, I think they were one percentage point apart. So this is a referendum.
Bush admits that we took a thumping, and he decides to dismiss Donald Rumsfeld.
He told Cheney, and Cheney said, "I don't agree with that decision."
The president took me aside and said, he didn't say, "I'm thinking about it." He said, "I'm gonna make a change." He didn't want another debate. We'd had that debate a couple of times. The president knew how I felt about it, and they asked me if I wanted to be the one to deliver the news. Now, that was easier for him. I mean, he didn't have to do it. But I also, I was the right guy to do it.
Secretary of Defense Donald Rumsfeld.
My first association with Don Rumsfeld was one of life's great turning points, both professionally and personally. On the professional side, I would not be where I am today, but for the confidence that Don first placed in me those many years ago. And on the personal side, it's enough to say that I have no better friend and ask for none. I've never worked harder for a boss, and I've never learned more from one either. I believe the record speaks for itself. Don Rumsfeld is the finest Secretary of Defense this nation has ever had.
The way the history works, you don't get a lot of credit for what didn't happen. You know, this is one of those kinds of situations. It isn't so much what you achieved as is what you prevented. Now you safeguarded against further attacks against the United States. I think that's a major accomplishment.
Please.
Mindful of the frustrations that many Americans are expressing to you, do you believe you need to make any adjustments in how you run the White House? Many of your senior staffers have been with you from the beginning.
I've got a staff of people that have, first of all, placed their country above their self-interest.
Very popular administration that had handled themselves very well after 9/11 was suddenly becoming unpopular. And it was not just unpopular by every 3 months, but by the day.
Cheney's approach to foreign policy and national security put Bush in a position of real danger in terms of his legacy.
Vice President Cheney's influence was somewhat diminished, and Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice, who was very, very close to the president, was sort of, her influence was ascendant.
In the last 2 years of the administration, Cheney remains deeply worried that rogue states will spread weapons of mass destruction around the world. He advocates a hard line against nuclear-armed North Korea. Rice prefers diplomacy.
North Korea had tested weapons, and it was their first nuclear weapons test. It was in the fall of 06. It should have been some effective sanction imposed, or some fairly dramatic action taken. Condi disagreed.
Bush chooses Rice's approach.
Are you concerned that the hardliners within the administration may undermine your efforts, the State Department's efforts?
Well, I think these are the efforts of the United States government, the last time I looked.
Cheney's concerns about treating North Korea too gently are soon realized. The administration obtains evidence that North Korean scientists are working on a new nuclear reactor in Syria.
The reactor's out in the middle of the desert. There's no population around it any place. They tried to hide it down in the Wadi Gully. You can't say it's to generate electricity. There's no power line coming out of it. It's just out there, obviously, for the production of plutonium. You don't want Syria to have that kind of capability that they might be able to pass along to Hamas or Hezbollah or Al-Qaeda.
When the intelligence agencies discovered that Syria was building a reactor that could soon make material for nuclear weapons, they had policy debates about it.
Condi recommended taking it to the United Nations. I strongly recommended that we ought to take it out.
Cheney was just a voice alone saying we have to attack and destroy this reactor.
I thought it would sort of, again, reassert the kind of authority and influence we had that we had back in 03, when we took down Saddam Hussein and eliminated Iraq as a potential source of WMD. There are certain bright lines out there, and you do not cross them. And one of those bright lines is you don't provide nuclear technology to terror-sponsoring states. And Condi was on the wrong side of all those issues, so we had significant differences.
Cheney was advising, again, a very robust and, in this case, unilateral strike against Syria.
I argued in front of the group and in front of the president. Got all through making the case again. I thought I was rather eloquent.
At one point, President Bush literally rolled his eyes
the president said, all right, he said, how many people agree with the vice president? And nobody put their hand up.
He was isolated and quite irrelevant.
In the waning days of the administration, Cheney presses Bush one last time over what Cheney considers a vitally important issue.
We do have news on former White House aide Louis Scooter Libby. He has been sentenced to 30 months in prison.
In 2007, Scooter Libby had been convicted of four felonies relating to the Valerie Plame scandal.
Prosecutor Patrick Fitzgerald told the court today Libby's lies created a house of mirrors for investigators. And Fitzgerald implored the judge to impose a tough sentence to make it clear the truth matters.
He was sentenced to 30 months in prison, a $250,000 fine.
He did not want what was going on in his office, in the vice president's office where he worked, to come out. So there are a lot of fingers pointing tonight at Dick Cheney.
The most immediate question for Libby, and therefore for Cheney, was whether or not Libby was going to go to jail.
The president commuted his sentence, so he didn't have to go to prison, which, when you think of it, is an outrageous proposition anyway. But he wasn't pardoned.
The end of the administration is swiftly drawing near. Before he and Bush leave office, Cheney wants a full pardon for Libby.
I know he got a lot of advice from inside, from his staff, not to do it. So I was pretty much alone in terms of my recommendation. I pushed very hard for a pardon. I thought a pardon was appropriate. But the president made the decision that there weren't going to be any more pardons.
It stuck with Bush that Libby had not been truthful and that he had gotten the punishment that he deserved.
Bush was absolutely adamant that Libby did not merit pardoning.
That was, that struck close to home. I felt we were leaving a good man wounded on the battlefield.
Cheney got right into Bush's face, was very hot about it, very insistent that it would be dishonorable and disgraceful not to pardon Libby.
It was a major strain on our relationship, obviously a source of considerable friction.
And it got so bad that Bush said to aides, I don't want any more visits by Dick Cheney. I don't want to take another phone call from him.
The president had the power to fix it and to make it right and chose not to.
The relationship between Bush and Cheney never recovered. It has yet to recover.
Cheney, one of the monumental figures in American politics, in the end did not work his will.
I, Barack Hussein Obama, do solemnly swear
that I will execute.
The last day after we had the inaugural ceremony, he and I departed out to Andrews Air Force Base.
President Obama was kind enough to allow one last flight to take President Bush home to Texas and Vice President Cheney home to Wyoming. A few of us, not many, flew home to his Wyoming home. I escorted him and went over the car, and they got in there, and I remember reaching in and shaking his hand and just saying, Mr. Vice President, on behalf of a grateful nation, thank you for your 40 years of service to the country. And the door closed and he went off to his home, and that was sort of my last memory of Dick Cheney serving him.
I don't run around thinking, gee, I wished we'd done this or I wished we'd done that. The world is as you find it. You've got to deal with that. You get one shot. You don't get do-overs, so you don't spend a lot of time thinking about it. I think that because the president wanted it to be a consequential vice presidency, it was. I think we did a very commendable piece of work under difficult circumstances, with a full understanding that it wasn't popular with everybody and that we were going to take a lot of incoming fire.
For the people who don't like Dick Cheney, they're going to see him as the Darth Vader that he always was during the Bush administration. On the other hand, I think there are a lot of people who see him as sort of the leading edge of the Bush administration's efforts to ensure that there wasn't another large-scale attack on the United States. And for that group, they'll be very grateful.
Cheney is maybe in a Venn diagram of one of people who are geniuses at political power, at understanding and acquiring power, and who are zealots. If you have someone who's both, he's going to move the needle on history.
I don't lay awake at night thinking, gee, what are they going to say about me now? I didn't worry about it a lot when I was doing it, and I thought the best way to get on with my life and my career was to do what I thought was right. I did what I did. It's all on the public record, and I feel very good about it. If I had to do it over again, I'd do it in a minute.